Welcome to A Friday Reads, where we talk about what I read, what I'm reading, what I hope to get to next, any books I may or may not have hauled, and actually some of these are from last week because I forgot to haul them because my brain's just chaos these days. So, things that I've finished. I think I've only finished two audiobooks since I last talked to you guys. So first one we'll talk about Crossroads of Twilight. That is done. Very happy to be done with the slog, hopefully. I've been assured. As I said in my Wednesday video, I've been told I am done with the slog. And the next book will have some relevance. We will see. I don't really have any other updates other than what I said last week. And also, like, some people thought I was angry last week. There was something that happened after I filmed that video that had me in a rage over that book for days. It's not that I was surprised the book did what it did. I was just very unhappy with how some clue giving was done in the book. I thought it was a little bit transphobic, and it's not like I'm surprised that a book written, you know, in the early 2000s would have this, and it's not a big deal, but it irked me because of all the other things that were irking me, but it's done. It's done. I do think it's my least favorite. I think Path of Daggers and It are, like, the ones where I'm like, this is where we can consolidate. This is where if I was editing your cover letter or whatever, I would say these paragraphs, these books, we can make them one sentence. We can work on this. So anyways, Crossroads of Twilight. I also finished Hood Feminism, which we're going to talk about on Jess Owen's channel in a couple weekends. Not this weekend, but the following weekend. Keep your eyes out for the exact day, but very useful nonfiction in terms of framing things. I feel like I didn't learn necessarily new things, which is fair. It's meant to be a diagnostic intro tool for this type of nonfiction, I feel, and I've read a lot of that. But I appreciated the framing and the inclusion of her own story into the book. So it was a good read. I finished that. So I think I primarily only finished those two audiobooks. No, I lied. I finished Slave to Sensation, which is the first Psy Changeling novel. I also talked about this on Wednesday. It was fun. Like, I don't think it's like a new favorite of all time, but in terms of just like that escapist, really fun fantasy romance. I don't know if it's fantasy romance. I keep saying I don't know what it is. It has shapeshifters, which makes my brain go fantasy for some reason, even though you could have sci-fi reasons for it. But I think I'm just like werewolves got to me first. Sort of thing. But you also have like telepathy and other things that I associate more with sci-fi. It's cool. I am excited to get to the next one when I'm next in the mood. So I think those are all the things I finished. And then I continued with Name of All Things. I haven't finished it yet, but I'm really close and I'm really loving it. It's just that, like, my brain has not been in the headspace. And what I mean by that is apparently I'm more stressed about writing simple 1 to 2 page documents for job applications than I was writing an entire dissertation. So I spent a lot of my brain power on that. But I think I got some of my documents in a better place and I've made different decisions about where I'm applying and I don't know. It's complete chaos. I don't love it. I kind of low-key want to be in a YA dystopia world where someone just gives me a job. Like, I know free will is supposed to be important, but I also would just like to be told, yes, this is the job you're meant to do, because I don't like searching. Anyways, that is to say, I haven't gotten as far into Name of All Things as I'd like, although last Friday, it was like 70 degrees in Boston, and I went out, and I just sat at my favorite park, and I read this book, and it was lovely. It was absolutely everything that I wanted. I keep sending Judith pictures of footnotes that I find really funny. Because that's how much I like the footnotes. Like, I don't even have to give her context for where I am in the plot. I just send a footnote. I'm just like, ha, this is funny. And it's a series where the antagonistic force kind of gets to make their pitch. And I love that. That's something I really enjoy. Like, I legitimately don't understand yet the scope of the entire series, why things are happening the way they are and what these prophecies mean and what's going to happen. But I know there are two sides and we are meant to be sympathetic towards one, but the sympathy for the other is increased in this book and it's fun. I'm here for it and I'm really, really enjoying it. So I'm hoping to have this finished this weekend. Like, it's going to be my primary read pretty soon. It's my primary fantasy read for sure. I don't think I'm reading any other fantasy right now. The other book I picked up because I wanted to read it, and I asked Jocelyn if she wanted to read it, and she said yes, and that's Do You Dream of Terra 2. This is my used bookstore copy. I am this far. I also have the Kindle, and I'm liking it, but I'm not loving it as much as some of my friends. I'm just going to put an image on the screen because I'm too lazy to hold a shiny book. But it has a really... I don't know how to describe the writing style, but it's a writing style that is very efficient and moving quickly. I guess I would say. Like, I wouldn't say it's simple or too direct. Like, it definitely does do work to get you into the mindset of the characters you're in. And as the book continues, I am enjoying the characterization more. But the initial premise of it, where we are anticipating the launch of this space journey with these individuals who will be in space for 20 plus years as they go to this new planet, the anticipation of that event was a little jarring for me in terms of character connecting starting there, but I also thought it made sense to start that way. Like, I'm not disagreeing with the choice. I just think it made for a jumpy start for me, but I am enjoying it, mainly because it has a writing style that, like, goes really quickly. It's easy to feel accomplished while reading this book. That said, it does handle some pretty, like, hard, like, internal struggle questions. There are a lot of dark things that have happened, and Jocelyn keeps using the word melancholy when reading this book, and I feel like because of the writing style, I'm not as in the atmosphere as she is. I think it's just a preference thing, so I don't get that as much, but I do get the sense that nobody's okay. Like, no one's in a good place. And yeah, it's really interesting. But I wanted to read this because it kind of fits in with a lot of sci-fi I've read the past couple months in terms of climate change and how we respond as a society and the different angles different authors have taken on that question. I think I might do a video on that just because I've read so many by accident. Seems to be this is the theme of our time that authors really want to parse and dive into. And it's fine. It's just, yeah, it's one of those things where I don't normally notice trends or things that are happening often, but in sci-fi, this is the question. Climate change is imminent. How do we solve that with space travel? Is a consistent theme that I've been reading and dissecting lately. And that, speaking of sci-fi, I actually have finished something, but the reason I forgot is I started and finished it today, and that is the second Murderbot book. I got the audiobook because I finished Hood Feminism and needed another audiobook. And so I have the Kindles, but I was like, you know, I've heard good things about the audiobooks. I'll give them a try. And it was really fun. Once again, it was like an episode of TV, which is exactly what I wanted. Murderbot got to form a new relationship, which I do see why people love that character. It's just pretty funny. Gets thrown into a situation, also just has to come to terms with, like, their personality and the idea of, like, I always did this job because I'm good at this job. And I also, like, want to do this job, but I kind of want to do it on my own terms. It was interesting. I don't know where they're going next, but in terms of, like, this episode with Murderbot, I had a good time. It was enjoyable. I don't know if I like it more or less than the first book. I think I really needed the escape that is associated with Murderbot today. Like, this week's meant a lot, so I felt accomplished and I was engaged by the story. It was one of those things where I left for work listening to Murderbot, and I came home from work listening to Murderbot, and then I finished it while having, like, my come from home snack before dinner, and it was just like a nice experience. So I feel like the experience also influences how I feel about the book. So those are the things. Like I said, I'm going to finish Terra 2. I'm going to finish Name of All Things. I do not know what might be the last book of the month because I won't have another Friday reads. You'll just have to check out the wrap up that'll be out in a couple weeks. But I'm sure I'll get to something. It might be that novella in the Middle Game series. It might be a different book off my shelf. I don't know. I'm going to just let myself decide. I think I've accomplished everything I needed to on my TBR. I might get a head start on next month's TBR because, I mean, I haven't made the TBR yet, but I have some obligation reads that maybe I should knock out now because next month is packed. Can already tell. Like, packed in a good way. But also, as I said earlier in this video, I wasn't expecting job hunting to be more strenuous on my reading life than writing the dissertation, but that seems to be where my brain's at, so who knew? And now for the mini book haul that I forgot to show you. So I'll show you the two books that I forgot to show you last time. One is Tor.com was really nice and sent me a finished copy of All the Horses of Iceland. I really liked this novella, if you didn't hear in my wrap-up from last month. It's so short, and I think it's just like a perfect sit down, read it in one or two sittings type of novella where you just go on this journey. I thought it was a really vivid and well done description of the 9th century Europe and Asia Silk Road travel pathway. Like, yes, there are some mystical folklore elements associated with the origins of these horses and some light witchcraft, but also just the idea of, like, magic in different cultures and different religions and things like that. And you happen to follow a character who is atheist and doesn't really know what they believe in magic as these things happen to him. So he's kind of just like a fun character in this type of setup. And you get to hear a story of how potentially the horses in Iceland are related to the horses in Mongolia. And it was lovely. So I'm really happy to have this. I kind of wish it had a map. Like, if any book I wanted to have a map, it would have been this one. But it's okay. I really like it, and I'm excited to have it and reread it. And also, like, this cover is so pretty. It's just so pretty. Another one I got because I've been waiting for this book at my bookstore because it's been out for a while, and I would always go to the sci-fi section and be like, why is this book not here? Why do we have every other book by this author? And that's The Echo Wife. You can't tell, it had a sticker here that I removed. And although the sticker residue's gone, I'll never quite get rid of this spot. Anyways, but then I saw on our remainder table, so at our bookstore, they have books that they put on sale. This was on sale for $7, so I bought it because I love this book and it's $7 for this hardback. I just hate that it had the sticker because I would have paid full price. It was just never shelved in the sci-fi section or in the fiction section. So I'm like, where's this book then? I would have bought it from you for, like, what was its full price? Oh, I don't know. They covered it up with the other sticker. But regardless, I assume it would have been like $25, $30. I love this book, so now I have it to reread one day if I'm ever in the mood for being with this character again, who is a trip. Also, I mean, besides this spot that I can't get rid of, I kind of like how it looks on camera with, like, the dusk jacket. And the last book I'll talk about, Evie sent me, and I think it was meant to go with this other short story collection I showed in my physical TBR video last week, but that's Children of the New World by the same author. I believe these are more sci-fi stories. I think. Let's see, a creative virtual memory struggles to distinguish real life experiences from manufactured events. It is a debut story collection. Okay. I don't know. This guy takes headshots with really interesting shirts. This is all I know. But really appreciative of this. Hope I like it. Put it in the stack of books that I have yet to read. And so that's the haul. For those of you curious about my Horizon Zero Dawn journey, I am now at, wait for it, 12%. Which is honestly an improvement. I was at 10% 2 days ago. When I say this is the first video game I've played since high school, I am not kidding. And it's been 10 years since high school. And I don't think I played it during high school, so I'm thinking middle grade. That might have been the last time. It's when I was like in 7th or 8th grade. I'm not horrible, but it takes me a while, and I'm starting to slowly not be as scared all the time because I have more tools to mitigate the threats. Because there are so many threats, but I love the world. I just went to this place called The Cauldron, which is basically just like a Terminator dungeon. It was awesome. So that's been fun. That's what I've been doing in video game space. And I did watch Turning Red. It was awesome. And I am not surprised, but also surprised at how upset the internet was. Like, not like the whole internet, but, you know, like that tiny, very vocal minority of the internet who's like, this will be damaging to your children. They said that with their entire chest, and I was just like, these are just weird teenagers. I don't understand. It was, if anything, it was more like, I don't know if kids would like this, if only because it's so 2002, which I was not expecting it to be so 2002. It was fun, but I was unprepared. So I think those are all my media thoughts. And if you want to leave an emoji, leave something. I don't think there are red pandas. That'd be great, right? If there was a red panda emoji. If there is, leave that. If not, leave a different animal of choice. Let me know what you're reading, watching, playing, anything. And like if you liked it. Subscribe if you want to. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye.